This con.
All right, here we go. If you let's wait for one more minute, Robert, and then we can start.
Sure, just give me a shout.
Sure. Okay. All right, Robert, let's start.
All right, thank you. You're doing
Robert,
on
so just before we start, a quick introduction about yourself, and then we can start.
Yes, of course. Good morning, good evening, wherever you are right now in the world, which time zone. My name is Robert Halm. I am heading the portfolio and business development business unit at Prismat. Just welcome you to today's session. I will just give you, let's hope I can. Okay, so the agenda for today, let's give me just a few short minutes to introduce Prismat. Pretty sure not every one of you is aware of who we are, what we do, and then we get right into it. Hope it's an interesting topic for all of you, the migration from the decentral SAP EWM business suite stack to the S/4HANA based EWM. And I'm sure we can, at the end of the session, we will still have a little bit time for your questions. So I would suggest that all the questions you have, just shoot them at me right at the end, because maybe during today's session, one or a few questions will be answered within the slides that I have brought. Okay, so again, Prismat is we are based more or less in Germany. We also are working abroad, follow our customers there, but we're mainly targeting here the European market. We were actually a spin-off from the Fraunhofer Institute for Material Flow and Logistics, founded in 1991. So we're quite a few years now on the market, have quite a lot of experience, very much focusing on logistics, SAP solutions and processes. And so that's what we do. What we are very proud of is to be SAP Focus Partner and a winner of Diamond Award in 2018, but also 2020. So the portfolio at a glance. Don't want to bore you with that, but just give you an idea what we're doing, focusing on the S4, of course, but also some of the attached modules and applications, as well as innovations targeting here the business technology platform and the enablement and user experience topics. So just to give an idea what customers we are working for, as you can see, there's plenty of different customers with regards to let's say, size, but also cross industry. So we're not focused on a particular industry or a particular, let's say, large enterprise or smaller, but we're actually working for all kinds and of customers and sorts of industries. Okay, so that's being said for Prismat, and then I think we start with the interesting part, the migration of EWM. Sure. So I was actually in charge with one of my teams for one of the first EWM migration projects that was delivered in 2020, and also one of the first migration projects that was a little bit special, but I will come to that in a minute. I'm gonna walk you the next couple, next 40 minutes around about through the various areas of such a migration, starting with the system landscape migration approach, coming to the different activities mainly, and helpful tools, some do's and don'ts, if you will. So first things first, I'm let's say borrowed some of the slides from the EWM product development, not because I'm lazy and cannot build them myself, but I'm sure you know these slides, you're familiar with that, and so from that perspective it's a bit better to understand what we're heading for. So what we're actually looking at as a starting point, in we are in the upper left corner here with the SAP EWM Business Suite stack, be it on EWM 9.5 or lower, connected to a S/4HANA ERP or an ECC, right? And what we also want to look at,
your screen is not moving.
Come again?
Your screen has frozen.
It's frozen? Okay.
Yeah.
We see the first slide of the presentation.
We can only see the first slide.
First slide, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. How can I?
Now it started to move.
Okay. What can you see now?
We can see how to migrate from a decentralized SAP EWM to S/4HANA, and the screen is like a webinar, how to migrate. This is what we see.
Okay, in the presenter mode right now?
Oh, yeah. No. You are sharing the presenter notes as well. You can hide that.
Okay, because I was actually hoping that you can see the presentation mode.
Nope.
Okay, maybe if I...
You can reshare, I believe.
Can I share again? So I'm not quite familiar with that go-to meeting thingy, but I try my best. Excuse me for any inconvenience here. Okay, maybe I share the entire screen. Hope that helps.
Okay, now you can try to move.
Okay, so what do you see now?
Now we can see, right, the first
one. Okay, so, thanks for the remark, and I hope that we can now start again with a perfect view. Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
Sure. So what I was talking about earlier was pretty much the different deployment options, and we are starting from the upper left corner. And what we do not want to take a look at is on different cloud deployment options, because that is something to be tackled in a different session, I would say. But what actually the recommended migration approach from SAP currently is the way from a decentral business suite stack based approach to a decentral S4HANA EWM based scenario. Yeah, so that is the current released approach, migration approach from SAP. But there are also some customers already running on an S4HANA ERP. And as we all know, the latest S4HANA stack already includes a full-blown EWM. So it might also make sense for customers that are already running on an S4HANA enterprise management to migrate their decentral EWM to an embedded EWM. That's currently not supported by SAP, as I said, but it's also possible. I will come to that in a moment. Good news is that EWM stays more or less the same. Yeah, if you compare Business Suite EWM 9.5 and EWM S4HANA based, the common core is almost identical. Yeah, that's also an SAP product development slide here, and I can assure you from past project experience that this is actually true. Yeah, but unfortunately there is some major change with regards to the master data distribution. That is the master distribution interface as we know it from the Business Suite stack. The famous core interface is being used, yeah, where actually the master data from the ERP are a bit transformed within that interface into a different business object or master data object on the EWM side. Yeah? So that is the past as we all know it, and the future with the decentralized EWM and S4HANA, we have more or less the same master data than on ERP side. So the master data will not be transformed anymore within the interface, but they will be replicated, let's say, in an almost identical way. That is something important to know because that has a major impact to certain customers, especially if you have enhanced the master data interface. Then you want to make sure that after a migration, the enhancement, if they still apply, will also have to be enhanced with the new interfaces, be it IDOC or be it also if you're, because this is just an example, if you have an S4HANA on the ERP side already, you also might want to use the DRF, the web services, different interfaces and also different methods to enhance those interfaces. Also, another challenge is a little bit the customer vendor integration that applies on the decentralized EWM. So there's also something that goes on top. But aside from that, actually no major change with regards to the core functionality. So that is pretty much the good news. And this actually, why am I showing this to you? Because it's actually not something related to the migration itself, because it's actually an integration topic. Because it applies also to net new EWM implementations on an S4HANA stack. But of course, it's a change for the installed base customers. So that's why I'm emphasizing this to you. Okay, so if we look on the landscape and the landscape impact, just as an example, a typical three-tier SAP landscape, as probably all of you know it from your customers, could look like this. with the ERP or the ECC or the S4HANA based ERP on the top, and the EWM, for instance, 9.5 on the bottom. And you have more or less three different types of connections here that you see on that slide. That is the master data integration that apparently goes from the ERP to the EWM, and it's not bidirectional. The transactional data, which is bidirectional distributed, like deliveries and so forth, and the transports, workbench customizing, and so on. So what will change during the migration project? Because this is something very important, because it's different compared to a ERP S4HANA conversion project. Yeah, on the ERP side, it's quite, let's say, simple. It's not simple, but on a high level perspective, it is. You can compare the S4HANA conversion on the ERP side with an upgrade project. You just import the S4HANA stack, and then the next day you have an S4HANA ERP. With EWM, unfortunately, this is not possible. So the migration from the classical EWM to an S4HANA based EWM really means to switch systems, to move with your entire customizing and implementation and set objects from one system to a new S4HANA system. So that's very important, because I can tell you from past experiences, you cannot emphasize enough on that. Even if you tell it to your customers once, you really want to make sure that they get this point, because it's very important. So during the migration project, obviously we built up a new system landscape, an S4HANA system landscape with our decentral EWM, and we connected to the ECC, or to the S4HANA ERP system that's already in place. That can go in parallel, that's no problem, because we using different interfaces. We have the distribution switches on the ECC side, where we can pretty easy distinguish between the target logical systems per warehouse number, and so it's basically no problem to distribute master data via the old interface, via the ZIF interface, to your old EWM systems, and also in parallel distribute the same master data maybe to the new system already, and then switch at the cutover dates your transactional data from the old systems to the new systems. So that is happening during the migration project, and after the migration project is done, so after the go live, you will just fade out the old system landscape. You might want to let the old productive EWM stay a little bit awake, just as a lookup system maybe, but maybe also some customers will need it for auditing reasons, depending on their size or industry or other constraints, but obviously you will not need the old systems anymore. Okay, so that is very important also for the system landscape. Once we have learned about the system landscape and the impact that the migration will have on that landscape. We will also take a look on the migration approaches, because there's also a little bit, a little bit of brain needed here when it comes to the implement to the migration approach. What we distinguish most likely is a landscape transformation and let's say a new implementation. Why is that? Because you might have customers that are running on an EWM already with warehouse number one. You might also have this customer running on a WM warehouse number two. And maybe the customer also has another plant or another site where no warehouse number or no warehouse management system is running at all. Yeah, but he plans to align his warehouse management strategy and bring all his warehouses to EWM. So what he can easily, what you can easily do is you can start, of course, with bringing the WM warehouses or the MMIM maybe managed sites to a new S4HANA based EWM warehouse number, and at a later point of time you can also migrate the EWM warehouse number or warehouse numbers to this very same S4HANA EWM system, where you already have some of the other warehouse numbers already running. So that's quite possible, and also some customers follow this approach. More common and more customers, especially those with just one warehouse and one warehouse number in EWM, they will just want to migrate their EWM warehouse to the new S4HANA based EWM. And there it's it's also important to know that if you have multiple EWM warehouses, you can also migrate them step by step. So if you have two warehouses or three warehouses, you don't need to migrate them in a big bang approach on one weekend, but you can also go for one warehouse this weekend and the other one 2 weeks later, and the third one maybe 2 months later, depending on your or the customer customer's constraints and requirements. What you have to keep in mind once you decided for a migration approach that fits best, that there are certain constraints that you also have to think about, and where migration project planning is really important. One of them is the downtime restriction or cutover duration. Because the migration, as I said, we need to move on with all our stuff from system A to a different system B. We cannot just simply make an upgrade. That's not possible. And this will also, for a productive system, take some time. So this is not going to happen within half an hour or 1 hour. It will take a little bit of time. So if you have a zero downtime customer, you have to come up with a solution. And also, if you have near zero downtime windows, you just have to think about, you have to practice upfront on a sandbox system, for instance. And there are also other options. But this is also one very important topic to think about and to keep in mind. What's also important is that during the standard migration approach, no open transactional data will be, or no transactional data at all will be migrated. So this means all open documents need to be finished and closed before the migration. So there's no open deliveries in the EWM. Everything on the outbound side that has started picking already needs to be posted goods issue before the migration, or you have to cancel, let's say, the picking and bring it to a, let's say, virgin state again. Same goes for the inbound deliveries. You need to post them all goods receipt. For instance, no open warehouse tasks. Also very important, the QM documents, if you have QM in place. So this is something that could be really crucial depending on the customer and the industry. And what's also quite challenging is the migration scope, the migration project scope. I recommend, or we recommend, actually to not bring much improvements and additional scope into the migration project. Our recommendation is migrate the processes in the first step as they are. Why? It has quite a benefit when it comes to testing, because you will need to test a lot on the target systems, and also on the training aspect. You have, if you have thousands of end users, you need to think about them. What you want, or what most customers want actually, is that the day before the migration, everyone shuts down the system, logs off from the system, and the day after migration, every end user logs onto the new system and doesn't notice anything changed. So that's the ideal scenario, that everyone, every customer is actually hoping for. The rest I already mentioned. And if you keep that in mind, then you are actually good to go to the to migrate the EWM. And actually, there are kind of 10 activities more or less that you need to follow. I have illustrated that here a little bit on an animated slide. So what we're looking at here is we have the S4HANA or ECC at the top. We have our legacy EWM business suite, EWM in yellow on the bottom. And in between, we have our target stack, our decentral EWM on S4. Okay, so what we, of course, need to start with is installing this new system, the new S4 system, and then we need to migrate the custom code and dictionary objects that we want to take over. So all the custom code, and that could be quite heavy, depending on how long the customer is actually running on EWM, or what kind of complexity he implemented in the past. I will give you an example in a few minutes how heavy that could be, but that needs to be migrated from one system to another system. Also, but that is not quite a migration topic, but also again an integration topic. Of course, you need to align the central customizing with the units of measures, for instance, and so forth. So everything that you have customized on the ECC side that you already aligned with the old system, you need to also align with the new system. And also keep in mind that we have with the material master certain changes, because the master data interface changed. And also with the customer vendor master data, with the customer vendor integration, there's also some changes that you need to keep in mind. We need to migrate to local customizing, so all your warehouse number dependent customizing, for instance, but also the customizing that is needed for the warehouse requests, for instance. You know, there's also some interface customizing, some mapping customizing with the document delivery document mapping. This is not warehouse dependent, but also needs to be migrated. We need to feed the new S4HANA system with all the master data we need. So that could also be quite a pain, especially if you think of customers that have millions of material master data, for instance, in their EWM system. That is also something that can be prepared up front. So that is not an activity that needs to be carried out during the cutover, but can be prepared well up front. So that's also a recommendation from my side. And again, we need to also migrate to local settings, be it warehouse dependent or warehouse independent. We need to migrate special master data such as routes, for instance, or packaging specifications, for instance. And of course, we have printer and user settings. If you want to print out from your EWM system, you need all the printers in the new system as well. With regards to the user settings, if you have, if you think of, let's say, your selection variants or your other settings, user-dependent settings that you have created in the old system, you might want to take over and bring it also to the new system just out of convenience. And in the end, I mean, if you use a lot of set tables, it also might make sense to migrate also the content of those set tables. So this is just an overview for all the activities, more or less, that you need to think of. The challenge for your custom code after a system conversion, this slide might be familiar for you because it also comes from the S4HANA ERP conversion slide decks. Of course, EWM needs also some S4HANA specific adjustments. Not so much because, as we learned earlier, we have a common core. The common core is still identical. There's not heavy simplifications that were developed so far from the EWM product teams compared to the ERP. So this is not a big issue, but still your coding needs to be HANA database ready, of course. So if you're not only coming from an EWM 9.5, but an EWM 9.5 that is not already running on HANADB, so your custom code needs to be HANADB ready, and some changes also apply in the S4HANA system. Two major things that I would mention here is the business partner integration. So whenever you select certain business partner specific things, this has changed a little bit due to the customer vendor integration on the S4 side, and also the material master handling a little bit. The interface master data distribution I already mentioned, but there could be also an issue with the length of the material numbers. But aside from that, it's no big issue. There are a lot of customers afraid a little bit that now EWM on S4HANA changed entirely and did it, yeah, it will be like a net new implementation project for them with hundreds of days. And I can assure you that's not the case. Huh? When it comes to tool-based migration support, then I will have to refer to the migration cockpit as a central point of entry here. Maybe you are aware with the migration cockpit that it's not something that is EWM specific, but it's actually coming from the ERP side, and it was also enhanced for EWM, but also for other components, as you can see here, available also for APO, apparel footwear solutions, and so forth. Yeah? So that's the migration cockpit that you could also use for migrating specific EWM business objects and master data from the classical business suite stack to the decentral S4HANA. So that's also, again, only supported for the decentral S4HANA. Yeah? The objects that are available since S4HANA 1909 and 2020, as you can see, is quite a lot. Storage bins, warehouse stock, product, and so forth are the probably most important ones. But you can also migrate the fixed bins, the resources, work center settings. If you have production integration, and you can migrate production supply settings, material flow, and all of that. Yeah, all. And I can also assure you that the 2021 release that will come up in mid of October this year will also have further objects available that were still missing. But I think the product teams covered the most important ones so far with the current S4HANA release. It's up to you if you use this cockpit. It's also quite okay if you're using other migration tools that you might be more familiar with. Yeah? You could still use also the CSV upload functionalities within S4. Regarding stock, regarding bins or bin sorting, could also help you in certain ways when you have issues with performance, because I can tell you from experience that the migration cockpit-based approach could be quite performance intensive for certain objects. So this is why I highly encourage you to use a sandbox approach and test upfront with your productive system copy just to get an idea how long the migration, especially for the stock, will be like. Okay, so from the theory, I also would like to talk a bit more about practical customer stories, practical examples. I have brought you three customer stories from different industries and also different, let's say, use cases or approaches. So let's start with the consumer products industry customer. This is a customer that has quite a first adopter strategy for SAP products. Strong SAP minded strategy and pretty much everything that is new from SAP, they consider using it. Huh? So that's the mindset they have. And so it was not quite surprising that as Jörg Michaelis, the chief product owner of EWM, told them that with S/4HANA 1909, it will be also possible to migrate from EWM 9.5 to the S/4 decentral EWM, that they immediately started with a discovery phase and with planning of the project. The scope was also quite interesting because we had pretty much everything implemented, starting with material flow systems, batch management, labor management, quality management integration, production integration, of course, heavy RF transactions that have been used, Fiori apps already in place, yard management, and also the transportation interface from EWM to LETRA. I can tell you that the project was took quite some time duration wise. Why? Because we had 12 warehouse numbers to migrate. All from production, some were production related warehouse numbers, and we had also some major DCs with thousands of handling units, hundreds thousands of handling units, to migrate. And of course, if you are quite early using the tools, then you are also a little bit cautious about how they work and if you have certain issues. And I can tell you also that we did have certain issues. We did get immediate help from SAP product management, and issues were being resolved quite quickly. But again, I think we went live with the first warehouse number in May 2020, and then 2 weeks after did the next four warehouse numbers, and 2 weeks after the next four warehouse numbers, and 2 weeks after the rest. So that was kind of like our go live approach for these 12 warehouse numbers. And also, there were quite some heavy customer coding and objects that we had to migrate. So we were talking about almost 1 million lines of code. So kind of kind of a thing, let's say. The next example that I have brought is from a customer that we migrated also in summer of 2020. It's a discrete manufacturing customer, and he was actually coming from an SCM EWM 7.0 that was implemented years ago. And he said, "Okay, never change a running system. We're all good." And then he decided, "Okay, maybe it's now a good chance to migrate to S/4HANA." The scope was not so heavy. We had two warehouse numbers here, production related, with a material flow system, serial number management, and so forth. The interesting thing here was actually the very old EWM release, the source release, and it was on an MS SQL database. So we also had the challenge to migrate also to a HANA DB. But also was a project duration of 3 months, actually. So as I promised earlier, it's not a rocket science to migrate from EWM to S/4HANA based EWM. And the last example that I, or last customer story that I brought today is the one of our most prominent stories from wholesale industry. And the challenge here for this customer was actually, or the question was, will he still need to run a decentral EWM? So he was actually running a decentral EWM for quite a while. Then he converted his ECC to an S4. And then he was just wondering if he could still move from the decentral EWM to the embedded S4HANA EWM. And this is a project that we are also delivered within 2.5 months runtime. Also, customer went live last year in April, I think. So, if I recall it correctly, it was one of the first migration projects from Decentral Business Suite EWM to S4HANA Embedded EWM. And all of those projects, by the way, were delivered during the Corona lockdown. They were, for in particular, this one was delivered entirely remotely. So no one of the team was ever on site at the customer sites. This is quite remarkable, and actually, just to give you an idea that this is also working. So lessons learned. I just brought top five. Have a good plan. I know that applies always. It's not something new, but here it is. Very much important that the determination of the migration approach as is versus redesign. I already told you I would always recommend the as is approach and do the redesign afterwards. It will help training and testing efforts keeping at a minimum. Have a detailed planning, of course. Do an impact analysis. For example, also for related support organizations, as I told you, interfaces will change, therefore also tools, transactions, roles that need to be adjusted, and all kinds of things. You need to have a plan how to deal with open documents. As I said, they are not being migrated, at least not by the standard tools. Also, be sure to have a good data consistency of your productive environment. Applies mostly for the stock. Because the migration tools, they are quite strict. If you have certain things where somebody might have adjusted a little bit on database level for some reasons and did it not in a correct way, and no one noticed, those tools will notice, and they will leave you then with those remainings, and that's not that's also a good reason for give it a trial in a sandbox up front. So the sandbox approach is something that we really recommend to do that. And be aware that it's not just an upgrade. It's really a migration project, and you should also treat it that way. And you should also tell the customer that it's not quite an easy thing, especially customers that are already familiar with the with upgrades in the past. And they say, okay, that's no problem for us. We test a little bit here, we test a little bit there, and then we're quite confident. You will need to test a little bit more. That's something that I can assure you. I brought you some slides for business value of migration. I mean, this is more from an IT perspective. Of course, as you can see here, There's quite a timeline for EWM, and you know, every year we did get a major release in the past, a new one. We will get with S/4HANA a new major release every year in the future, and therefore it's quite also important for customers to keep a little bit up to date. Of course, you don't need to upgrade every year, but we actually recommend every 3 to 4 years maximum, because you always get trouble with new feature integration and so forth. And also from a business perspective, I strongly recommend in detail to take a look at the Roadmap Explorer. There you get a really convenient list of all the features that have been added to the product, and then you can go in a deep dive with the customer what business value will bring the migration from a business process perspective. Just to highlight, let's say, my top five, top six, of course, the production integration, there has been and still being invested a lot. The new shipping and receiving, the advanced shipping and receiving with TM integration. Also for production, the Tucker train or distribution equipment. Embedded analytics becomes more and more important for customers, and of course the user experience with SAP Fiori. And there are also tons of minor improvements. Some of them will be very helpful for particular customers, some of them not. So that kind of like depends on your customers. But I really recommend you take a look at the Roadmap Explorer, pull a list of all the features and functions from the source release to the target release, take a look at the roadmap, and then you get a pretty good idea in your business value proposition. Key challenges, I already told you the most important ones. So there's like no migration tool available for customer specific coding and dictionary objects. You have to think of a way how to do that. Also, the transactional data will not be migrated with any sort of standard tools. I can also ensure you that it is a good idea to reinforce the migration team with migration experts, because if you are in the cutover and you have some issues with the stock migration, that will be a pain, I can assure you that. So this is just a sales slide. We will, of course, from Prismat have different offerings for a migration assessment. Of course, we support all our customers with migration strategies and value propositions and so forth. So this is really a good idea to have a good and experienced partner that supports you during the planning, at least, of the migration. Yeah. Okay. So here is also, I mean, the slides are being shared afterwards. I just added a few further information here. Highly recommend the blogs from Amar Kumar from SAP Product Management, and also the Roadmap Explorer, just to give you an idea. So having said that, that's my last slide actually. Thank you very much for your time. I hope it was interesting for you. Still have a few minutes left for your questions.
No problem. So thank you very much for your time. And then I must say that this was a very, very, very honest presentation. And yes, you really, put together a real life pain scenarios where, customers can face the challenges and what value, Prismat can bring. So I must say, very honest and very good presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
And now we can open the forum for the questions. But before we go ahead, we have one question already, which says, do you suggest Big Bang migration to S4HANA from both ECC and EWM?
Actually, no. Because, what I understand is that you're talking about the ECC conversion to an S4 on the one hand side, and on the other side, the migration from the EWM to the S4 based EWM. I would not suggest to follow a Big Bang approach here, because from our perspective and also experience, the project teams on the customer side, you have the same people, dealing with the ERP stuff, and also dealing with the interface, dealing sometimes also with EWM related stuff. And it's quite a challenge. And if you have the chance, I mean, sometimes the constraints are as they are. We all know that's a daily life project. But if you have the chance, do it in two steps.
Okay.
It will just relieve you a little bit from the pressure.
Right. And then do we have any tools available in the market which will help us migrate apart from which standard SAP provides?
Yes. Actually, there is what you can do is you can do database-based migration. So what it is basically what the tool does, and there are different tools available. What the tool does is basically migrates the database content from one system to the other system. You will have to do some adjustments on the target system. Afterwards, so it's not like a piece of cake that you just push the button and that's it. But that could be a different approach. The benefit here is that you, of course, with that approach also migrate open documents, because you literally freeze the situation and take over the entire snapshot from the source system to the target system. There are different different tools available, and there's also a customer service being provided from the SLT teams from SAP, but also other partners offer a database based solution.
Sure, thank you. And then we have one more question. Is it a good approach to have a DRF model for material master transfer from ECC to EWM decentralized?
Is it a good approach?
It is in the comments. If you want to read that, it's in the comments.
Yeah. I'm just reading the question. I don't know. Okay. Okay. Non S4. Yeah. Actually, it depends a little bit, but the DRF currently only supports the with the web services the business partner distribution. Yeah, so the material master distribution also within the DRF is using the MatMas IDOC. So I would not suggest using DRF only for the material master, but if you want to use DRF, for instance, because you have the customer vendor integration on the ECC side already activated, and you might want to have the same business partner number for one entity on both systems. Yeah. So let's say customer Robert Halm has the business partner number 123 on the ECC side, then you might want to have the same business partner number 123 for this customer also on the S4 side. And this is supported by the DRF. If you might want to use it for that approach, then it's also, of course, the Material Master comes with it. I just don't want to, I would not suggest or recommend to use the DRF only for the Material Master and use the business partner distribution via the IDOC.
Okay, okay. So one more question I have, which says, what do you expect from the new release for EWM from the migration perspective? Any expectation from SAP?
Yes, we will have some enhancements for the handling units. Mm-hmm. Currently, no empty handling units are being migrated. So especially if you think of automatic warehouses where you might have empty bunch of empty handling units, for instance, those will not be covered by the migration tools so far. And also related to the handling units, if you have customer specific enhancements, they will also currently not be supported by the migration objects, and they will probably be subject to change. We all know that right. Will be supported by the new release.
Right. Okay. So one final question: can we move from 9.5 to S4 Cloud directly?
Well, that depends a little bit on what you mean with S4 Cloud. If it is the I assume you talking about private cloud edition, right?
Right. Yeah. Even this is my understanding.
Okay. Yeah, the private cloud edition is no problem. If you're talking about the public cloud edition, then it just doesn't work. Yeah. Private cloud okay. edition, no problem, because this is more or less a hosted on-premise appliance.
Okay. All right, so that's about it. And yes, one final question that we'll take. We have already exceeded the time. So is it that we close the transaction data and then we migrate? This is the strategy that we adopt?
Yeah.
All right.
So again, if you have open inbound deliveries, open warehouse tasks, open outbound deliveries, they will not be supported by the migration tools, and also it's quite challenging to migrate the these documents because of the database states, of course. I'm the best approach is to encourage the customer to close them up front before the cutover. If that's not working, there are ways around it, but you have to be creative there. So that does not work without specific developments.
Yeah, I'm getting the point. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, this makes a lot of sense. And that's it with the questions. And once again, thank you very much for your time. And then I hope to see you again on this webinar again.
And, yeah, again, thanks thank for having you. Me. Was a great pleasure. Hope we see us soon.
Well, sure. And looking forward to it, man. Thank you very much. Thanks again.
Perfect. Have a wonderful day, evening,
thank
and
you.
Weekend.
Thank
bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Don.
Thank you.